His people that were raised from the dead, when they came back, no story was told. There are some people, they don't want to depend on the Bible, on the doctrines of the Bible, on the teaching in the Bible, only to hear stories that somebody was raised from, and they have written a book. And they're disputing the book. You don't find that in the New Testament. Dorcas, Eutychus, all the people that came back from the dead, when they were restored, no story. In fact, Jesus said, when that other man sent Lazarus to the world so that he'll preach to my five brothers, Jesus said, they have Moses and the prophets, the writings of Moses and the prophets. Let them hear them. Oh, the man said, no, Father Abraham. If somebody rose from the dead and he told them stories that they have heard up there in heaven, then they will repent. And Abraham said, if they hear not Moses and the prophets, neither will they repent, even if somebody went out of the grave. Well, I mean that, you know, our confidence is not somebody that rose out of the grave. Our doctrine is not built on somebody who rose from the grave. Our doctrine is built on the word of God. And we're not to add anything or subtract anything. We're not to add the words of the dead, only the words of Christ. So, as they have come back from the dead, give them something to eat. Feed them with the word of truth. Feed them with the scripture that saves lives. Look at it in verse 28 again. Take heed therefore unto yourselves and to all the flock over the which the Holy Ghost has made you overseers to feed the church of God, which he has purchased with his own blood. For I know this, that after my departing shall grievous wolves enter in among you, not sparing the flock. And also of your own selves shall men arise, speaking perverse things to draw away disciples after them. Therefore watch and remember that by the space of 3 years I cease not to warn everyone night and day with tears. Now, brethren, I commend you to God and to the word of his grace. If they come back from the grave, commit them to the word of his grace. Give them the bread of life. Lord, evermore give us this bread. Teach them the truth. And if they're little children, they're people that need to be trained, train a child in the way he should walk. She died, she came back, train him, train her. She died and she came back, feed him, feed her. He died and now he's risen again. Feed him with the word of life. I commend you to the word of his grace, which is able to build you up and to give you an inheritance among them, among all which are what? Sanctified. Very important. We're looking at 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 2. 1 Peter chapter 2. Give us something to eat. Give him something to eat. And the thing to eat so that his soul will live forever when he eventually dies is the bread of life, the word of life. In 1 Peter chapter 5 verse 2, feed the flock of God which is among you, taking oversight thereof, not by constraint but willingly, not for filthy lucre but of a ready mind. I'm looking at John chapter 12. You remember in John chapter 11, somebody was raised from the dead. What's his name? Lazarus. Now look at John. Look at what followed after that. John chapter 12. We're looking at verse 10 and verse 11. But the chief priests consulted that they might put Lazarus also to death, because that by reason of him, many of the Jews went away and believed on Jesus. Lazarus was sick, and eventually he died. He was buried. After 4 days, Jesus got there, and he said, roll ye away the stone. They rolled away the stone, and eventually he said, Lazarus, come forth. And Lazarus was restored back to life. And many of the Jews then started visiting the home of Martha and Mary. And the chief priest realized that it's this raising of Lazarus from the dead that has caused all this. They were not happy about that. Because of that, Lazarus had enemies that he never had before. Lazarus now had some danger that he never had before, because the chief priest consulted how they might put Lazarus also to death. So, after somebody has been raised from the dead, is it that everybody is going to be happy about him? Not necessarily so. If you bring him back from the dead, there must be protection for that man. And it's not just what the chief priests are talking about, even the devil. When somebody is raised from the dead, because of that raising from the dead, the adversary, the devil, and the demons, and the evil spirits, and the people that do not like the gospel, and the power, and the penetration of the gospel, they're going to be against that man. And they're going to say, because of him, that's why many people are believing on the Lord now, and they're going to be enemies of this man raised from the dead. You are going to have to protect that man spiritually, protect that woman spiritually. I'm looking at 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a running lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour, whom resist steadfastly in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplishing your brethren that are in the world. It's telling us that, you know, when somebody is raised from the dead like that, Satan will be against him. Evil spirits will be against him or against her. And the people of the world that do not like the propagation of the gospel, because of that person now, many people are believing on the Lord. They're going to be against him. And the church is not going to be saying, we're rejoiced, we're happy, she's raised from the dead. How is she now going to overcome the adversary, the evil spirit, the devil, the Satan himself, that our own lion wanting to destroy him? You must teach him and teach her how to overcome. That's why Peter in Second Peter chapter 1, the responsibility of the church, the responsibility of the brethren, the responsibility of the people. And all those people have received such a miracle. Look at verse, you're looking at it from verse 5. And beside this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness. If you know anyone that has been raised from the dead, as the, you know, people are coming with their cameras to take photographs, and journalists are coming to get words out of him, out of her, as magazines are being sold, as the fellow becomes popular all over, just because he was raised from the dead, even becomes more popular than Peter, that raised him from the dead, that raised her from the dead. The fellow is not going to study the Bible again, only telling stories, you know, I died, and, you know, I spent one day there, I spent 3 days there, and then I was raised up, and I came up. He's not going to give even the glory to God. Pride might come in, a lot of things come, but Peter the apostle said, whoever they are, whether they never died, or they were never sick, or they were sick and they were healed, or they died and they were raised from the dead, teach them, train them, instruct them, that they will add virtue, add knowledge, they'll add temperance, they'll add patience, they'll add godliness. And then from godliness, they add brotherly kindness and charity. Look at verse 8, for if these things be in you and abound, they make you that ye shall neither be barren nor fruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But he that lacketh these things is blind. Anyone raised from the dead, he lacks faith and lacks development and increase in knowledge, is blind. And what good is he that he has been raised from the dead, but now he doesn't have spiritual knowledge, spiritual growth? He's blind and cannot see afar off, and he has forgotten that he was purged from his old sin. Wherefore, the rather, brethren, give diligence to make your calling and your election sure. For if you do this thing, you shall never fall. Responsibility of the church for people who have received miracles, whether they are raised from the dead or they are just healed, is that will make help them never to fall. Chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. Chapter 3, verses 17 and 18. You therefore, beloved, see ye know these things before, beware lest ye also, being led away with the error of the wicked, fall from your own steadfastness. Help those people to be steadfast. Help that little girl that was raised from the dead, 12 years of age, to be steadfast in worshiping the Lord and reading the Bible and coming to church and fellowship with the people of God, giving glory and honor to El Dorcas, who has just been raised from the dead, to be steadfast in the things of the Lord and to continue in good works, in verse 8, growing grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be glory both now and forever. And everybody said, Amen. Raising the dead is a great exploit of a single moment. Doesn't take 5 minutes. Didn't take 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 1 hour for those people. It's an exploit of just less than 1 hour. After that restoration to life, what follows is more than 1 hour. I'm using the word practical because I told you about practical responsibility. Practical P. They must be protected from the adversary of their soul after they are raised from the dead. The church now and the brethren and the saints, Peter presented Dorcas unto them. Why are you presenting Dorcas unto us? For protection from the adversary of his soul. And then why are you presenting? Because you know, when Lazarus came forth, he said, loose him and let him go. Where are you going? I'm going back home. What shall the people at home do? They must protect him from the adversary of his soul. Are renewed in holiness daily. What's the use? Somebody went to heaven already. Leave him there. When he comes back, if he's not going to be renewed in holiness every day, leave him in heaven. Let him stay in heaven. It's better for him. But you bring him back here, and he's not perfecting holiness in the fear of God. What use will that be? Renewed in holiness daily. A is to be attentive to the voice of the Lord. If he diligently hearken to the voice of the Lord your God, then I'll not bring any of disease upon you. There was a disease that killed them. Sin no more, lest a worse sin come unto thee. And now are they going to keep away from the sin, from the sickness that killed them originally, by being attentive to the voice of the Lord? See, consecrated to cleave unto God. And you see, brethren, how many of you remain alive today of those who cleave unto the Lord? And so when they are brought back from the dead, they are consecrated. They must be consecrated to cleave unto the Lord. Train them to walk in the narrow way. Train them to walk in the narrow way. Generally, when people receive spectacular miracles like that, if they are not careful, they become careless. I am special. Nobody has gone through what I've gone through. Nobody has got what I've got. And they become frivolous and careless. All they might be, even become worldly. But you train them to walk in the narrow way. They are instructed in the whole counsel of God. Paul the apostle said, I'm pure from the blood of all men, because I've not shown to declare unto you the whole counsel of God, all the counsel of God. And cease to continue in grace, godliness, and good works. Dorcas, welcome. Welcome. You are here before, you did many good works, and you had grace in your life, and you are godly. Now you went. If we have left you there, you'll get your reward. Now you've come back, added days, added duty, added period, and it's added program and project. Now you must continue in grace and continue in godliness and continue in good works. A is to be armed fully, to withstand in the evil day. To withstand in the evil day. Look at Ephesians chapter 6. Ephesians chapter 6, I'm reading there from verse 13. Ephesians chapter 6 from verse 13. It says, wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that she may be able to withstand when? In the evil day. And having done all to stand in the evil day. Do you realize that when a saint dies, that saint is taken away from the evil to come? If you bring that saint back, the evil to come is still there. Let me show you. Isaiah chapter 57, and I'm reading there from verse, I'm reading from verse 1. The righteous perisheth, and no man taketh it to heart. And merciful men like Dorcas, merciful people like Dorcas, are taken away, and none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. The righteous is taken away from the evil to come. Brethren, if you bring Dorcas back, Then you must understand, you must make her armed fully, put on the whole armor of God to be able to withstand in the evil day. Bringing the dead back is not just, you know, a miracle of one day. You must continue the responsibility and duty of a lifetime. L is to live constantly under the Lordship of Christ our Lord. To live constantly under the Lordship of Jesus Christ our Lord. I'm coming to point number three now. A purposeful revelation in restraining death. A purposeful revelation in restraining death. Have you heard this before? Prevention is better than cure. Have you heard that before? Prevent the sickness. That's better than making the person suffer so much and then looking for a cure. Prevent the death. That's much better than making the person already or the person dead. And now you're looking for raising from the dead. Prevent that death. That death can be avoided. I'm thinking about a lot of people that died in the Bible. And if somebody has spoken to them, the death could have been avoided. Think about Abimelech. Abimelech would have died, but it was prevented. How was it prevented? The Lord spoke to him. And we can do that with our neighbors. We can do that with everybody. We can do that with believers and prevent them from dying so that they can avoid the death. Before I read about Abimelech, do you remember other people that died? And I say unnecessary death. And I say avoidable death. I'm thinking of Nadab and Abihu. Nadab and Abihu. All Aaron, their father, needed to do was to warn them. Are you going to give sacrifice? Are you going to burn incense? Don't bring any strange fire. That sentence alone will make them avoid the death that they died. I'm thinking of Abiram, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram. And just tell them, don't do what you're trying to do and don't rebel. You can avoid the death. And it's better to avoid the death than after the death, somebody is running around saying, I want to pray. Ahithophel, God has given you wisdom. And see this Absalom trying to go against his father. Ahithophel, you will die. Come out of that. And we can make Ahithophel avoid that death. Absalom, what's your problem? This project will land you in the grave. Come out of that. Don't fight against your father. Because if you fight against your father, you know that the Almighty God anointed your father and made him king, and he has not anointed. Don't die untimely death. If somebody spoke to Absalom, he could have avoided the death. Adonijah, what's the problem with you? Solomon has become king. And then he pardoned you for your foolishness, saying, a king reigns in the land. And he says, okay, Adonijah, I forgive you. Don't do that again. And then Adonijah said, mother of Solomon, can you talk to Solomon? What do you want me to tell him? That this little girl they gave unto David before he died, and now David is gone. Can I have that girl? Oh, I'll go and talk to Solomon. And then Solomon was in the palace, and the mother came, and you know, the mother said, hey, my son. And the son, Solomon, came down, you know, bent before her, and said, my mother, what do you want? I said, I'm going to make a request of you. Don't deny me. Of course, I'm your child. I will not deny you. Can you give this lady, this girl, to Adonijah? Why don't you ask for the throne for Adonijah? God, do so to me and more so. If Adonijah has not demanded this for his life, Adonijah died. Adonijah, I'm telling you that, you know, could have the other ladies there in town, you could have prayed and got married to them rather than having this. Now he lost his life unnecessarily. Amnon. Do you remember Amnon? He was feeling like, you know, wanting to have something in the of the flesh with the Tamar. And what are you doing, Amnon? You don't know Tamar. You don't know that his senior brother is Absalom, and that man, you know him. He'll get rid of you. If you're going to even feel a temptation towards anybody, beware of Tamar. But you know, nobody spoke to Amnon like that. That's why Absalom arranged and killed him. I'm thinking of Ahab. He shouldn't have died the way he died. A prophet came and said, I saw this and that, and I see that the shepherd of Israel is gone, because the whole place is scattered. He said, keep this man. And when I come back, I'm going to take care of him, put him in prison. And the man of God said, if you come back, the Lord has not sent me. He knew he was going to die because the prophet had said so. he could have avoided that death. I'm saying that many people that died and then after that were praying and praying and praying that they rise up, many of them, we could avoid this Achan. Don't take that thing, it's a cursed thing. And by just removing your hand from that thing, you can avoid the death. Other than after you are dead, somebody is trying to pray. Avoidable death, untimely death. I pray you'll not die prematurely. Something can avoid, or not you avoid it. Ananias and Sapphira, they shouldn't have died. And, you know, husband and wife. And then as they were, you know, they made all this arrangement. And then, is it not so much you sold the land? Yes, he fell down, he died. He didn't have to die that death. And I'm saying, church, look at your Bible. And then have the wisdom of God. And live a life, and your life will be long. Nobody will kill you. You will not die prematurely. And let me tell you something. Now, we're told Ananias, when he fell down, and the wife not knowing what.